Hello and welcome to my seminar. I am Dimitrios Papoulias, currently a postdoc researcher at the University of Athens, and today we'll be discussing a brief summary of my research activities. So first of all, I will start with a few motivations behind my studies, and then I will focus on the phenomenological analysis I do in the area of neutrino physics, direct dark matter detection, and taxon-like particles. So let's get started first with the neutrino sources. So as you can see, neutrinos are one of the most abundant particles in nature, coming from different sources across a wide range of energy. And in this talk, I will be focusing mostly on terrestrial, reactor, solar, supernova, atmospheric, and accelerator neutrinos. So with neutrinos, from kV up to gV energy. So one of the most important processes in my research is the coherent elastic neutrino nucleus scattering, or SEVENS, which is the process where a neutrino scatters off a nucleus and the nucleus remains in the same nuclear state and scatters as a whole particle. So coherent elastic neutrino nucleus scattering has a really large cross section, but there is a caveat here, which has to do with the available energy to be measured, which is the recoil energy. So while the neutrino nucleus coherent scattering cross section is the largest in the neutrino world, and it scales with the neutron number square dependence, on the other hand, the maximum recoil detectable energy is inversely proportional to the nuclear mass, and therefore it lies in the order of a few kV, making it a really difficult task to be measured experimentally. So that's why it was detected for the first time only after 40 years after the original proposal by the coherent collaboration here, you can see, on a cesium iodine detector in 2017. Later, it was detected on a liquid argon detector in 2020. And finally, the coherent collaboration in 2021, it released the full data from the cesium iodide measurement. So in this talk, I will be discussing the analysis we have made with the full coherent data available. Another experiment that I'm interested in is the deep underground neutrino experiment, also called DUNE. And I'm currently running an LIDEC project at the University of Athens with a special focus on the NIR detector. Finally, I'm also interested in experiments where the neutrinos are not the signal anymore, but they form the background. Actually, in direct dark matter detection experiments, neutrinos constitute an irreducible background, which we also call it the neutrino floor, as you can see down below. I will be discussing more about that. So let me start with the standard model physics with coherent elastic neutrino nucleus scattering. The cross-section you can see here is a really simple cross-section, and it consists of two important quantities. One is the weak charge with red here, and the other one is the nuclear form factor. So the weak charge contains the particle physics information, and in the standard model, it depends on the weak mixing angle, the number of protons and the number of neutrons. So because this quantity here in parentheses is really small, it is basically negligible in view of the large coupling, in the view of the large neutron coupling. And therefore, we say that this cross-section scales with the neutron number squared. On the other hand, the nuclear form factor encapsulates all the nuclear physics effects, and it also consists the major source of theoretical uncertainty. So it is rather important to put constraints on these two quantities, the nuclear that come from nuclear physics and the weak mixing angle. So let me start with the nuclear physics first. So as you can see here, I have a cartoon of the nuclear RMS radius for protons and neutrons. So let me tell you that for the proton case, we have good measurements from electron parity validating experiments, but for the neutron case, this was not the case. So before coherent experiment released the data, there was no way to determine the nuclear RMS radius, and the only way was through nuclear theory models. So now with the data available, we analyzed the coherent data for both cesium iodine and liquid argon. And for the first time, we have a data-driven determination of the neutron RMS radius. And our limits are shown here at one sigma regions. And they are also compatible with nuclear theory models. Another important quantity, like I said before, is the weak mixing angle. And actually, we can perform precision tests of the standard model away from the Z-pole, where we have a very accurate measurement of this quantity. So you can see here that in the low energy regime, there are no many experimental determinations of this quantity. And the only available information we have comes from the RGE extrapolation of the weak mixing angle. So with the new data available, we have performed an analysis. And here we present the combined constraint coming from the analysis of cesium iodide and liquid argon data. As you can see, the data, the error bars are rather large for the moment, though consistent with the RGE extrapolation. However, in the long run, with new experimental data coming from improved background determinations and lowering thresholds, we will be able to perform a much better determination of the weak mixing angle. So let me now quickly pass to new physics beyond the standard model by focusing first on the case of neutrino non-standard interactions or NSIs. So the NSIs can be formulated in terms of the effective four fermion Lagrangian, as you can see here, where these epsilon parameters in red determine or quantify the strength of the new physics interaction with respect to the Fermi constant. So in the presence of NSI, the seventh cross-section become, first of all, flavor-dependent, and it is obtained through the substitution of the weak mixing angle, of the weak charge in the standard model by the new weak charge in the presence of NSI. So the new weak charge in the presence of NSI contains these epsilon terms that quantify the strength of the new interaction. And we have two contributions. So in the upper row, we have non-universal or flavor-preserving non-standard interactions, while in the lower row, we have flavor-changing ones. So here, I will just, as an example, I will show you the results assuming a non-universal NSIs only. So I will focus on one NSI for the neutrino electron, for the electron neutrinos, and plus one NSI for the muon neutrinos. And all others will be set to zero. So you can see that after the analysis of the individual cesium iodide or liquid argon data, we have already meaningful constraints, which are compatible with the LMA solution. And also, it is very important to mention that they rule out the LMA dark solution. In the right-hand side instead, you see the combined analysis. So assuming both datasets, assuming these two non-zero NSIs, and of course, we narrowed down the area even further, still excluding the LMA dark solution, which comes from oscillation searches. So already we have a very meaningful constraints from this experiment. Now we can think on simplified scenarios where a light vector mediator could induce new contributions to coherent elastic neutron nucleus scattering. So I have the cross sections here. As you can see, at some point there can be a cancellation between the standard model and the new physics interaction, and this manifests in this weird area here. So anyway, we have put the constraints in the in the parameter space of mass and coupling. And as you can see, already we exclude a region in the parameter space from a few hundreds of MeV up to GeV. And we provide a complementary constraint with beam dump experiments, colliders, and astrophysical constraints and other experiments that we'll be discussing later on. We have done the analogous case for the case of a light scalar mediator with similar results. So again, here we have a new contribution because of the new scalar mediator. In this case, there is no interference with the standard model as expected. Therefore, there is no this weird shaped area that was in the case of vector couplings. And again, we perform complementary and complementary analysis to existing ones from other experimental probes. We can also look at specific models that are anomaly free, for example, the B minus L and the L mu minus L tau extra U1 symmetries. And here I present the recent result we got from the analysis of the coherent data, xenon and tone, LZ, and dune. So you can see, especially for the case of L mu minus L tau, the dune sensitivity here with blue, because of the very intense flux of muon neutrinos available at Fermilab, is able to place significant constraints, ruling out other areas probed by other experiments. We have finally looked at NSIs from unification models. For example, we consider the various manifestations of physics theory with special cases of chi, psi, and eta models. And we compared the sensitivity that could be obtained at the dune detector here with blue with other experimental probes like Coherent, Dresden 2, and Texono, which are SEVENS experiments and neutrino electron scattering experiments. Finally, it is also possible to think in a wider framework and incorporate all possible Lorentz invariant structures and consider pseudoscalar axial vector tensor mediators, as we have done in this work, but I will not discuss about it any longer. So let me now change subject and continue with neutrino oscillations, and I will firstly discuss the case of sterile neutrinos. So this type of experiments looking for sevens are are ideal locations to look for sterile oscillations. So there will be a depletion of the neutrino flux because of the presence of sterile neutrinos. So we have put our first results from the analysis of coherent data. However, we see that there is a really poor sensitivity for the moment. However, as you can see here in the next generation of these experiments, it will be possible to even probe the LSND and Minibund oscillation exclusion areas. So the future is promising. So another possible case is to consider that possible departures from unitarity of the neutrino mixing matrix. So this is naturally obtained if we assume an extra singlet neutral heavy lepton that mediates light neutrino mass generation. And with the goal here is to constrain the non-unitarity parameters through the neutral current. And as you can see, this can be obtained if we consider that the new part of the neutrino mixing matrix is this matrix that leads to non-unitarity, which is multiplied to the usual 3x3 PMNS matrix. So if non-unitarity is present, the standard oscillation probabilities will be dependent on these new non-unitarity parameters. So luckily, because of the very short baselines of these coherent elastic neutrino nucleus scattering experiments, we have the so-called zero distance effect. And this is good news because There is no dependence on other CP evaluating phases that are relevant for oscillation searches. So we can have a clean measurement of these new non-unitary parameters. And this is what we have done here. We consider proposed experiments that are about to run in the next decade. And we have put the projected constraints on this we probed the projected sensitivities on these parameters, on the non-unitarity parameters. And as you can see, in some cases, there are either similar to current oscillation limits or even better. So you can see for the diagonal parameter, they can become even better, even with only 7 ton of detector. So the news are very promising for the non-unitarity as well. So let me now change subject and continue with electromagnetic properties using solar neutrinos. You will see why I'm doing that with solar neutrinos instead of sevens. So let me quickly remind you that since neutrino oscillations are observed, we know that neutrinos are massive and therefore they may acquire electromagnetic interactions as well. So if we expand the electromagnetic vertex function, we can see that we have Lorentz invariant form factors that account for charge, unupole, magnetic, and electric dipole moments. But here I will focus only on for the case of magnetic moment. So I will only discuss this form factor. So at direct dark matter detection experiments that are exposed to astrophysical neutrinos, mostly solar neutrinos, atmospheric and diffuse supernova neutrinos, as you can see here. If we focus on to the new xenon 1 ton and LZ data, in the region of interest, for these two experiments, only PP and the beryllium line of neutrinos are relevant. So we have simulated the expected signal at these experiments from solar neutrinos, taking into account detector-specific quantities like the efficiency and the resolution effects. And we have calculated the expected event rate. So now, looking back at the electromagnetic neutrinos, the electromagnetic contribution to the neutrino electron scattering cross section has this simple form here. And because it is a helicity violating process, it adds incoherently to the standard model. So we have that the total cross section is just the addition of standard model and electromagnetic contribution. On the other hand, the neutrino magnetic moment is an effective process dependent quantity that is different for a given neutrino beam. So if we have reactor neutrinos or spallation source neutrinos or solar neutrinos, this parameter is in reality expressed as a function of the fundamental transition magnetic moments, as I will be discussing later. So back to direct dark matter detection experiments, we have simulated the LZ and the xenon 1 ton signals, as you can see here, and we have put the most stringent constraints on the effective neutrino magnetic moment, which is also consistent with the current best limits coming from astrophysics. But from terrestrial experiments, these constitute the best upper limits we have up to now. And they are of the order of 10 to minus 12 Bohr magnetons. So let's make a deep dive to the electromagnetic neutrino vertex. So as you can see, for Dirac or Majorana neutrinos, the electromagnetic neutrino vertex will become different. So because of the structure of Dirac and Majorana neutrino, Dirac and Majorana Hamiltonians, in contrast to the Dirac case, for the Majorana neutrinos, we have vanishing transition magnetic moments. So we need a way to express the effective magnetic moment in terms of fundamental transition magnetic moments. And this can be done in the flavor basis in a trivial form, as you can see here. where these lambda matrices are these quantities, which are an arbitrary complex matrix for the case of Dirac neutrinos and an antisymmetric complex matrix for the case of Majorana neutrinos. And then by rotation, introducing the transformation with U being the lepton mixing matrix, we can rotate to the mass basis, which is the actual quantity that we are interested in. So we have analyzed the parameter space with two transition magnetic moments that are non-zero at a time. And as you can see, for the different cases of neutrino sources, for example, the LSND has mu neutrinos, GEMMA is a reactor neutrino experiment and has electron antineutrinos, while xenon 1-ton is a solar neutrino experiment. Well, it's not exactly solar neutrino experiment, but it is exposed to solar neutrinos. And so we have different a different determination of the parameter space. And as you can see here, the case of GEMMA experiment, which contains one of the most stringent limits on the neutrino magnetic moment, is also compatible with the much poorer limit coming from the LSND experiment. While for the Dirac case, this is not true. So there is a way to discriminate between Majorana and Dirac neutrinos through electromagnetic neutrino properties. This is the taking the basic message from this study. So now, for example, here you can see the most general expression, including oscillation effects, to express an effective neutrino magnetic moment. And here we have the most general case where you have active neutrinos in the initial state and 3 plus m neutrinos in the final state, where m is the number of sterile neutrinos, basically. So for the case of one sterile neutrino, the solar neutrino effective magnetic moment is expressed in this way. And here we have put some constraints, assuming that a dipole magnetic moment induces upscattering, an upscattering process with the production of a heavy sterile neutrino in the final state. So this is the big picture in the sterile neutrino mass and neutrino magnetic moment parameter space, where you can see that low threshold experiments like those looking for neutrino electron scattering or Borexino, which looks for solar neutrinos, they do better for the case of the neutrino magnetic moment, while the high energy experiments like Dune, Miniboon, IceCube, they do better. Lead to better constraints for the case of the sterile neutrino mass, just because of energy conservation. So now I will skip to direct dark matter detectors, and I will consider now that instead that the neutrino induced signal is basically the background. So as you can see, this is the expected differential event spectrum of neutrinos in a xenon detector that is subject to neutrino emissions from the sun, the atmosphere, and diffuse supernova. But as you see, the boronate contribution. Let me go back. So you see here, this is the boronate contribution. Can be perfectly mimicked by a 6 GeV WIMP, while the same happens for the case of a 100 GeV with the atmospheric neutrinos. So there is a question at some point that there will be a situation where we will not be able to know whether a signal is neutrino-induced or WIMP-induced. And this happens as long as the experiments are improving their backgrounds, and also they get larger with more exposure. So all these facts will lead to a point that dark matter experiments will start detecting solar neutrinos, and therefore there will be no way to discriminate whether they have detected WIMPs or neutrinos. So to do, we need to go through a statistical analysis, which is usually done through a likelihood ratio. And in that case, we need to consider all the flux normalizations and uncertainties of solar, atmospheric, and diffuse supernova neutrinos. And we do that through a profile likelihood ratio, and we test the null hypothesis where we have only neutrinos versus the alternative hypothesis, which is basically the WIMPs plus neutrinos. And by doing so, we obtain the so-called neutrino floor, as you can see here with these weird peaks. And below this area, there is no way to say that an event is coming from a neutrino or from a WIMP scattering. We have furthermore went one step beyond that and considered the possibility that also this neutrino physics contains some new physics. Probably one example could be a new vector boson like I showed you before. And in that case, you see that as long as we go to smaller masses, which correspond to basically lower thresholds, because of this of the propagator here, we have this inverse recoil energy dependence. The neutrino induced signal in the presence of new physics explodes. And therefore, the background becomes larger, which means that the sensitivity becomes poorer. So here we raise the point that new physics can crucially modify the expected neutrino floor. On the other hand, we utilized the measured Seven's cross-section along with its uncertainty. So what we did is that we extracted the Seven's cross-section, central values and standard deviations from the measurement of the coherent experiment for both cesium iodide in the left and liquid argon on the right. And we did that by weighting the theoretical standard model value of the Seven's differential cross-section with a multiplicative factor. And then we performed a chi-square spectral fit. So in that way, all possible uncertainties that the cross-section can involve independently of assumption are encoded. So we call it a data-driven determination of the neutrino floor. So we plug this extracted cross-section along with its uncertainty for each bin back to the profile likelihood ratio. We perform again the statistical analysis. And here we present the modification to the neutrino floor with respect to the theoretical calculation. So you, with dashed lines, you can see the data-driven determination. And for the case of a cesium iodide, which is close, very similar to xenon, you see that in all cases we have basically an improvement of the we have basically an improvement of the exclusion regions, while for the case of liquid argon, the behavior is exactly the opposite. This is because the cross-section for the case of cesium iodide is smaller than the standard model expectation, while for the liquid argon case, according to the coherent data, it was exactly the opposite. And so now let me completely decouple from neutrino physics and show you how neutrino physics experiments can probe other type of physics beyond the standard model, like axion-like particles or ALPS. So as you may know, axions are Nambu-Goldstone bosons from the breaking of a color anomalous global chiral symmetry, which is spontaneously broken in the vacuum. And in that case, the mass and the coupling are related. However, these seem to be already excluded by now. So there are more general ideas like axion-like particles or ALPS, which are pseudo-Nambu Goldstone bosons of a spontaneously broken global symmetry. I have some examples here, but the important thing is that in that case, the coupling and the mass are not related anymore, which means that the mass does not arise from QCD effects. So experimentally, there are many, many efforts that aim to constrain the parameter space of axion-like particles. I have some examples here. And here our goal is to explore the ALP parameter space in view of reactor neutrino experiments. So how to do that? Basically, in reactor neutrino experiments, we have a huge number of antineutrinos from the core, but we also have a huge flux, a huge photon flux. Here I present possible sources of this huge flux, huge photon flux, as you can see here. And these photons will interact with whatever material is around there. So basically, it will be the core itself, which would be uranium. So you can see the various contributions to these photon cross-sections, which can be Rayleigh, Compton, photoelectric absorption, or electron pair production in either nuclear or electron field. So our goal here is that to consider the possibility that a fraction of these photons would be converted to ALPS. So if there is an ALP, a photon ALP coupling, or an ALP electron coupling, or an ALP nuclear coupling, then it is possible to generate ALPS from these photons through a Primakov process for the photon coupling, or a Compton-like process for the electron coupling. Sorry, these two cases will yield a continuous ALP flux, as you see here, according to this expression. While from nuclear de-excitations, we will have a monochromatic flux. I will focus on the photon coupling here. So we consider this possibility, and we analyzed possible future data from near-term reactor neutrino experiments. And our constraints are shown here. So you can see that we can probe the area constrained by solar action experiments like CAST and SUMIKO. We can visit areas obtained from ALP effects in neutrino emission by the supernova 1987A data. We can also visit areas from that are derived from stellar cooling arguments, and we can put complementary constraints to beam dump experiments. So here, this area, this triangular area, is the so-called cosmological triangle. And we can test, in that case, the assumptions of the lambda CDM hypothesis. So also, it is important to consider that these experiments, the CAST-SUMIKO supernova, are not subject to laboratory-based sources. And therefore, under some assumptions, if we have medium effects here, these limits might not apply at all. So it is important to have a laboratory-based determination of this ALP parameter space. So that brings me to the end of my talk. So in summary, I discuss the subjects I am interested in with neutrino or dark matter physics. And you can see they include electroweak precision tests, nuclear form factors, new interactions, synergies with dark matter, and as well as supernova and oscillation searches. So with that, I will close. I will just briefly wrap up and tell you that I discussed standard model precision tests, electromagnetic interactions, violation of lepton unitarity, sterile neutrino oscillations. I also discussed how neutrino events are important in direct dark matter detection experiments and how we can have new directions to action-like particle searches in neutrino experiments. And with that, I thank you very much for your attention.